And that was really cool though, it gave me a bit of confidence. The first love song I ever wrote is tragic, but not in a good way. But definitely, one thing it showed, I think, people like my parents, was that I had that not just love for singing, but a love for playing the piano and songwriting quite young. I guess people were impressed at the time, and I could never really read music that well. That's why I was wanting to make up my own chords on the piano, even before I knew what the chords were. And I don't really know where that came from. I think it was just encouraged by my parents loving music so much, but I wanted my own music. I didn't want to copy anyone. Like You Love Me is, that's quite personal too, because it's about having two different sides to your personality. It's saying that there's a real vulnerable side to you, and then there's quite a strong, confident side. It's not every day you wake up and admit who you really are. I think one of the hardest things to do when you're in a relationship is let somebody see all those different sides of you, and it's a real test to see if they will love each part of your personality, good or bad. So Like You Love Me is saying, will you like the insecure sides as well as the really good, strong, confident sides? But it relates to everything, not just relationships, all kinds of things, you know, friendships, problems that you may have in your life. So it's about acceptance. Do you see how when you see me, understand how insecurities and accept the part she plays in me? Could you love? I went through all the normal processes of going to school and stuff like that, and I met Judy Zook's stepdaughter, Annie, and me and her had become close friends, and she heard me singing in the bathroom in college and said, "You must come meet my dad, he's a record producer and my stepmom's a singer." Judy Zook sung a song called Stay With Me Till Dawn, which came out in 1979. Judy Zook played me some of her album, and I was blown away by her voice and her lyrics and everything like that. And she said, "I'm going to go do some tours. Do you want to be my backing singer?" So I was 17 by the time I went on the road with her. And it was, you know, musicians on the road on a tour bus, playing at every pub and club in the country, staying in hotels overnight, not getting no sleep. You know, just doing the real live circuit, which was brilliant, because I don't think many people have that experience at that age. So it was a really good way to get into it, I think. She's sort of where I see people like Sarah McLachlan or Dido or Jewel sort of being, you know, being inspired by people like Judy Zook. So close, no matter how far, couldn't be much more from the heart. Forever trust in who we are, 'cause nothing else matters. The song by Metallica, Nothing Else Matters, was always one of my favourites, and we decided that I would cover it, and me and Mike Peden, the producer, were sort of big fans of the idea, but we were nervous as well because we thought it's such a great song. So many you know, Metallica fans absolutely love it, so we didn't want to sort of, we wanted to be true to the version, but also do something different for my album. Metallica were one of my favourite bands, and I loved, you know, I loved that song. I thought it was absolutely amazing when they performed it live with the orchestra. Never care for what they do. No, never care for what they know. No, but I know. I was obviously nervous because I thought, you know, can I really cover such a great song? And we've done a version of it, and I love it. It really means a lot to me. So I'm hoping that people will like it, even if they love the original version too. It was definitely a buzz. You know, you walk into a club and blaring out the speakers is jumping and people singing along, and you think, when people sing along to lyrics that you wrote, it's just totally bizarre. I didn't expect it to be Liberty X covering it, so when I found out they were doing it, I was really excited. It's quite a departure from my own style, and I had to stop doing it for other people because I'm sort of losing my identity in a way, and I wanted to put my own stuff, my own songs out there, and again, you're singing your own lyrics, what your true feelings are, as opposed to writing for other people. And obviously it means a lot more to me to do it myself and to be an artist and to be heard in that way, although it's exciting having stuff out there anyway. the showcase that I did was just such a buzz, because obviously I've been doing the support tours, and when you're a support, you know, people have come to see somebody else, and you've got to hold the audience's attention, and although you've got to do this anyway, the showcase, I walked in and there was this, you know, big stage and a huge 9-foot grand piano with, you know, gospel singers and a 6-piece string section, and I was just overwhelmed that all this was there. It was like there for me to go and play for people. I love playing with my band. We all get on so well. We have a chemistry on stage together. And I just had the time of my life. I was nervous, and as soon as my foot touched the stage, all the nerves went away. Just having that kind of production behind you means so much, and yet you can still sit there and do it at the piano. But it was a real buzz, definitely. Performing live, you get to perform with amazingly accomplished musicians, and the people that are in my band, it's a real thrill to play with them and see how good they are. And it's just the way I feel when I'm on stage. I feel like this is what I really want to do. I never want to come off stage once I'm on. But also, it's of course, your audience. That's the, you know, it's the massive part of what you do, and seeing them react is an amazing thing, especially if they react the way you want them to, and they get something from your songs and your performance. It's a really amazing feeling.
Lucie Silvas is an actual fabulous voice, and I'm not going to play around any longer. I'm just going to introduce her right now, ladies and gentlemen. Lucie Silvas, please.
Lionel Richie, that came about, it was something totally unexpected. I've been listening to Lionel Richie since I was about 5 years old, and Endless Love was always one of my favourite duets of his. And when I found out I was going to be filling Diana Ross's shoes for a night, I thought, oh my goodness, big shoes to fill. Amazing. I was really nervous. I remember waiting backstage, and I could see, you know, he was doing singing the song before, and I was thinking, oh God, counting down the seconds before I had to walk on. And as I walked on, he was standing there, and he was, you know, smiling away, and it put me at ease immediately. And although I was still nervous performing, I was sort of gazing at him during the performance, almost losing concentration, thinking, this is, you know, the legend Lionel Richie. He's written more classic ballads than most people out there. So I was kind of like, what am I doing here on stage with him? I thought it felt like a real proud moment.